Good evening and a warm welcome to one and all of you present here, and a very, very warm welcome to our special guest of the day, Srimati Professor Sunaina Singh. It's a very important topic that we are going to address today, education. Education is an important fundamental tool for the progress of a nation. Teachers are the very foundation, the soul of the education system. Disha Bharat, along with conducting personality development programs for students, also conducts faculty enrichment programs called Prerana, a journey from teacher to a guru, highlighting the important role of a teacher towards nation building. Teaching is not merely a profession, it's a great responsibility too. Teachers are the connect between the present and the future. They have a great role and of course an opportunity in nurturing, molding and inspiring the young lives. Values are caught and not taught. So, hence, it is imperative for a teacher to adorn the role of a guru. As we all know, in our culture, Bharatiya culture, guru has played a very significant role in our society through his exemplary knowledge, life and character. He has not only transformed lives, but also safeguarded the personal and social values. So, Disha Bharat conveys this very profound message of journey from teacher to a guru to in all our FDPs, and thus empower our teachers to become catalysts of social change. Post-pandemic, we started online teacher enrichment programs to accept and adapt to the new normal. And the topic was eternal torchbearers in the ever-changing world. And friends, hundreds were really, they all appreciated this program and very, very deeply benefited out of this program. And last but not the least, we all know and we're all aware, this last July, we had this NEP rolled out by the government of India, undoubtedly a visionary policy. So Disha Bharat conducts workshops every month in the name of Vikasana. Every month, it's a one-year project. Almost 9 events are over. Every month, last Friday of every month, we conduct this program and the webinar series, and teachers from across India are participating in this program. And the objective of this program is to sensitize and inspire and prepare teachers to in implementing the policy in its true spirit. Thus, Disha has been giving its own way. We are trying to reach the teachers, to enable teachers and enrich teachers to become catalysts of social change. So this is what I have about teachers and enrichment programs from Disha Bharat. Now I request Anand Krishna to introduce the guest speaker. And before that, I would like to introduce Anand Krishna, who is a software engineer turned MBA. He's worked in for the last 22 years, he's worked in major corporates like PwC, Infosys, and major other companies. And presently, he's a content writer, executive coach, and an international coach for the corporates. And his passion is also service. And he's also a volunteer with Disha Bharat. Over to you, Anand. Thank you so much, ma'am. Welcome to you once again for accepting this program. Thank you so much. Namaskar. Over to you, Anand.
Thank you, Rekha ji. Namaste. Namaskara. Good evening. Welcome to the 10th session of Disha Bharat's My Bharat lecture series. The topic for today's talk is Education and Innovations in Bharat, Journey Since 1947. We are all fortunate to get this opportunity to listen to Professor Sunaina Singh, an eminent academician, leader, and institutional builder of international repute. It is my privilege today to introduce to you Professor Sunaina Singh, our speaker for today's session. Professor Sunaina Singh is among the most prominent leaders in higher education, not just in India, but across South Asia and the world. She is currently the Vice Chancellor of Nalanda University, an internationally acclaimed historical university located in Bihar, where she is engaged in the mammoth task of rebuilding what was a renowned ancient center of learning. She has successfully served 2 terms as Vice Chancellor at the national level and is widely acknowledged globally for her contribution to higher education, scholarship, her leadership, and institutional building. Professor Singh has also been the Vice President of the Indian Council of Cultural Relations. In December 20, 2020, the Academic Union of Oxford made Professor Sunaina Singh an honorary professor of Oxford University in recognition of her contributions to promote Indian higher education and culture. The citation acknowledges her remarkable achievements of reinventing the academic architecture of the historic Nalanda University. As a distinguished academician and administrator, Professor Singh is a member of several distinguished boards at the national and international levels. She is a recipient of several prestigious awards, including the Vishwakavi Rabindranath Tagore Award by Oriental Heritage, Innovative Vice Chancellor of the Year by Asia Today, Most Admired Woman in the Education Sector by Knowledge Review, International Education Award 2018 by the British Parliament, the House of Lords, London, the Bharat Shiksha Ratan Award in 2018, the Education Leadership Award by the World Education Congress in 2017 and 18. Needless to say, there are many more awards and recognitions that Professor Singh has won in the course of her distinguished career. She has also made a unique and impactful contribution to social causes. Inspired by her sterling leadership and commitment to philanthropy, a group of citizens established a foundation in her name in Hyderabad about 6 years ago. This foundation works to achieve her vision of building a better society through the education of economically challenged girl children. We are indeed very fortunate, all of us, to have in our midst Professor Sunaina Singh today, and we all look forward to an inspiring, stimulating talk from her. Thank you so much. Over to you, Professor Singh.
Thank you. Thank you. Namaskar and good evening to everyone. I must say it's a pleasure to be back with Disha Bharat. I remember some time back we were engaging on diverse issues of NEP. I must congratulate Disha Bharat for bringing in different scholars from across the country, scholars and knowledge workers, including people from defense to talk to the general audience in celebration of our 75th year of independence. Now, my task has been, or I've been entrusted with the task of education, the progress of education since independence. So what would I plan to do this evening? It's like this. Now, let me just chart my way through the talk that I would be presenting this evening. I would look at education and how did we evolve, innovate through the journey of education in India. Now, it's very significant that we begin with a statement that a nation's success is determined by the education ecosystem that we establish, and therefore the strength of every country lies in its youth and the kind of education that we provide. So the footprints of progress that are indicated through the journey of education has been very, very, promising in every sector and in every move forward since the independence. But I think it's important to look at, how did we traverse this long distance? So the trajectory of growth and progress since independence has seen, or we have moved through and by overcoming enormous challenges and also creating immense opportunities for higher education. This has been, a very arduous journey in the history of a nation since independence, because we were looking at how do we make ourselves qualitatively better over a period of time, particularly given the diverse and the varied education system that we have in India. So breaking the colonial barriers, and moving from Macaulayan education system to the NEP, the National Education Policy, which has been a landmark in the history of not just education sector, but I think in the growth of the nation, it envisions not only an Atmanirbhar Bharat envisioned by our Honorable Prime Minister, but it recapitulates the learning of our own Gyan Parampara. You know, we've had an unbroken literary tradition of over 5 millennia, you know, which has been compared by Aurobindo to the ever-flowing Ganga. You know, this is where I think the Indian knowledge tradition is part of our journey, part of our psyche, part of our culture, and part of our sensibility. While we move in the 21st century and into a multipolar world with its own set of challenges, I think it does us good to remember our own knowledge tradition. You know, the Vishnu Puran had said, Tat karma yatna bandhai sa vidya ya vimukte, which means that our work should be such that we are not trapped into the bonds of any kind of attachment. And true education liberates an individual. I think that has been the crux of our Indian knowledge parampara. Now, when we look at Indian knowledge tradition, it's defined by Darshan Shastra, Gyan, and Vidya. You know, these are the three, I'm just trying to focus on the three that have actually explained how knowledge is important to India, because we were known for our insights, wisdom, and Gyan. So when we look at the Darshan Shastra, what is Darshan Shastra? It's a philosophy, it's a system. The perspective and the wisdom and the worldview of Darshan Shastra leads to Gyan. You know, the perspective, it's a system where the perspective, and this is very intrinsic to Indian ethos and psyche. It leads to, because the worldview here, the perspective that we learn and evolve over a period of time leads to Gyan, what we know as knowledge. And when knowledge is organized, systematized for the purpose of reflection, meditation, or pedagogy. For us, meditation is reflection. You know, we have our beads that are, you know, we find Saraswati, we find a lot of our gods with the beads there, that's reflective. You know, you have knowledge, Saraswati, you have one book, a book in hand and a rosary bead. You know, whatever one learns, it needs to be reflected upon. It's only then that knowledge translates into wisdom. So that's the kind of, tradition we've had. So reflection, meditation is also learning for us, and pedagogy. You know, when it is systematized, it's called Vidya. You know, that's how, Vidya is a discipline. Vidya is, again, a kind of how we make a distinction between Darshan Shastra, Gyan, and Vidya. I don't think there is any corollary of such nature in the Western or European tradition or any other education system. So this is something that seems to, bring to the core a magnificent view, perspective of what education is all about. You know, Vidya, the entire body of organized knowledge is Vidya. That's how we look at it. And Vidya, again, as per the Mundoka Upanishad, has defined it in two terms, as Paravidya and Aparavidya. Now, Paravidya is the knowledge of the Brahman, the Paramatma, the metaphysical domain, whereas the Aparavidya is knowledge of the worldly domain, knowledge that is secondary to the means by which we grasp the Brahman. So what we learn, what we teach is Aparavidya, mostly in institutions. And Vidya is shaped by Dharma. You know, without the concept of Dharma, I think nothing evolves in Indian ethos. This is very primary to Gyan and Vidya. That is where you find that even in Bhagavad Gita, the Gyan mark, it's a yoke. The path of knowledge is primarily through realization, which we I generally talk about Atmanavidhi, you know, self-realization. How do you expand the self, know your own self? I think this is very important because this is what the Gita has to teach us. So education, if you look at it from the lens of ancient knowledge tradition, it involves a wide spectrum of human development. Education is all about character building. It's all about how do you evolve, how do you lay in the forefront the ethics of one's own personality. How do you evolve? You know, this is very important to knowledge tradition that we had or we still have. Some of us are familiar with that. And I think the NEP now does lay focus on how it's important to dwell into our own knowledge resources. We have a wide spectrum of knowledge. We have unbroken tradition of knowledge. The literary output is comparable to any part of the world. We are the highest there, you know. Therefore, it's important that we look within as we study and as we learn about the world outside. I think it's important that Atmanavidhi and, you know, how the knowledge can liberate one, you know, Sa Vidya Ya Vimukte. I think that's very important, you know. So, Tat Karma Yatna Bandhaye. This is very important because we need to break the barriers, the trappings that tend to, you know, grasp the man in such a way that you find in today's materialistic world, more and more people are trapped into the clutches of I, me, and myself, one's own materialistic development. I think knowledge teaches us, our own vidya teaches us to move out of that domain. I think that's the most important lesson that India can give to the world and will continue if we learn to not only teach, but learn for ourselves and propagate our own knowledge tradition. At Nalanda, that has been my objective in trying to look at Indian tradition itself and see how knowledge can be disseminated in different forms. Now, what have we done since 1947? You know, we witnessed that Indian higher education has made metamorphic changes, metamorphic transformation, you know, with the challenges that we had to face, enormous challenges, given the colonial setup and the mindset and the education system itself. But then we traversed through the Gurukul tradition, through the Gurukul to the monastic tradition of Buddhist, you know, that's where Takshashila and Nalanda are very well remembered even today, because they have set a benchmark which is very difficult to cross by any institution of any kind of repute today. Because the kind of education, the kind of multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary education, how the knowledge seekers were beckoned by Nalanda, how it was a beacon of hope and wisdom for international seekers of knowledge who traveled through months together to reach to Nalanda. You know, the very story of the security guard. You know, these days security guards are mere security guards, whereas then, you know, the guard was a knowledge guard. You know, every student who came had to go through several questions through the gates of Nalanda. Otherwise, they had no entry. They had to travel back, you know, unless they satisfied the intellectual strata of that period. So keeping that in mind, how did we move? You know, if we jump to pre-independence, in 1918, the first college was opened in Bengal, Serampore, you know, the western part of India. And in 1857, we had University of Calcutta, Bombay, and Madras. that was set up. Around the time, 27 colleges were affiliated with these three universities. And I'm taking a quick journey into how did we evolve, how did we innovate, and how did we keep innovating thereafter. 19 universities were there at the time of independence. We're talking about 1947, 48, around that time, not even 20, you know. A remarkable growth and progress, because today if we look at our own institutions, imagine 1947, 19 institutions. In 2021, we have about over 1,000 institutions, degree awarding institutions. I'll come to that a little later. Now, it's important that through the journey, we ensured or we believe that the linkage between learning, research, innovation within the domain of higher education was key to building a sustainable future for India, key to building sustainable knowledge societies or knowledge culture or a knowledge country. You know, that was the key, and we believed in that, because the linking of knowledge or learning, research and innovation is the only way to move forward. We also found that the different kinds of institutions in India, you know, we started with central, state, unitary, affiliating institutions. Then again, we graduated to institutions of national importance, deemed to be universities, open universities, private universities, diverse kind of, the kind of higher education system that we have. One of the, I think, the largest education system in the world. The multi-faculty institutions, mostly it was universities were multi-faculty. The single faculty or single domain were agriculture, technological, medical institutions. We were governed by multiple agencies, and the first one to start was University Grants Commission in 1953. UGC Act was passed in 1956. That was setting of the growth radar there. The growth of, therefore, post independence has been phenomenal, because if you look at half a century later, 70 years later, you find that the development has been mind-blowing, because in 1950 to 2012, we moved from 19 to 700 institutions. 2021, we moved to over 1,000 institutions. And the gross enrollment ratio in 1950 was 0.1 million. Whereas today, we are over 38.5 million in 2020. This has been a remarkable journey for India. But we also find that education has, as I quoted and I have spoken about the ancient knowledge tradition, you know, F.W. Thomas, who has researched extensively on education across the countries, you know, he said at some point that education is not exotic or, it's not something that needs to be developed in India. It's already intrinsically there. So he said there is no country where the love of learning has so early an origin or exercised so lasting and powerful influence over the centuries. Now, post-independence, a number of education commissions, I think to be exact, there were 15 education commissions that were set up by the government at different points of time. And each one of them was looking at the suitable modifications in the structure, which is pattern, objectives, aims and objectives of education and curricula. Now, University Education Commission, the first commission that was set up in 1948-49 was headed by Dr. S. Radhakrishnan. This was a University Education Commission, where you had a distinguished scholar of Eastern religion and ethics, at University of Oxford. I'm talking about Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, and a former vice chancellor of Banaras University, who later rose to the august position of president of India. Now he submitted, he studied what needs to be done where education is concerned in India. He submitted the report in August 1949 with the aims of education and he started by saying to teach that life has a meaning. Now, the very first aim was that life has a meaning. He's starting with the Indian ethos to awaken the innate ability to live the life of soul by developing wisdom, and I'm quoting him here, by developing wisdom. Again, a very, being a professor of Eastern religion and ethics, he was looking at our own knowledge tradition in terms of how do we evolve and innovate our education system. So self-development was central to this commission in its report. The second education commission that came was in 1952 or 53. Since I'm tracking the development, how we have evolved, that was in 1952-53. It was called the Secondary Education Commission, also known as Mudaliyar Commission. Now, this focused on, under the chairmanship of Dr. Mudaliyar, who was Vice Chancellor of Madras University. This focused on, they focused on the goals of education. The commission was looking at how do we develop democratic citizenship, also to develop and improve vocational efficiency, to develop personality, to develop leadership at school level. It's talking about, all this is at the secondary education level. So this commission was the second commission that played a very important role in innovating and evolving the education system. The third was, of course, the Kothari Commission, which people generally refer to. This is again an education commission that came in 1964-66 under the chairmanship of Dr. D.S. Kothari, an eminent scientist and an educationist. And the unique feature of this commission was specific aspect of education. How do you inquire into education? So they looked at education as the most powerful instrument of national development. And the goals of education here were fourfold as per this commission. That was education for productivity, education for social national integration, education for modernization, and education for social and spiritual value. So these were the fourfold report that they submitted. We then travel down the memory line to the national policy on education. Now, very different from NEP, which is National Education Policy. Whereas earlier we had National Policy of Education, 1986. This policy actually formulated the suggestions or incorporated, the Secondary Education Mudaliyar Commission, then the Education Commission of Kothari into a national policy on education. 1968, they incorporated that as well. And they translated into a detailed strategy. 1968 National Policy on Education was also brought in, much before the 86 one, which was the first national policy on education. The second being the 86 one, which looked at strategy of implementation of access, quality, quantity, utility, and financial outlay. So they were focusing on how do you provide education to the citizens. Look at our population even around that time. So quality being important, how much, what needs to be taught, the utility of education, So it was more a kind of a utilitarian philosophy that was brought in around that time. And then you find that challenges of education were evolved. You know, there was a paper that was circulated for public opinion, which was called Challenges of Education in 1985, just before this policy, which were again incorporated. So education should be a national curricular framework. You know, there should be a national one curricular framework, which contains a common core along other important components, which need to be flexible. Now, this is what this particular policy said. Now, this policy was revised in 1992. Because the review of NPE 1986 was conducted during the period 1990 and 92. It recommended certain modifications in the light of development in the country. And they said that they just modified two paragraphs, were added 2 new paragraphs and 34 modifications to 1986 education policy were brought in. They again envisaged a common education structure, a pact throughout the country. Now this led to, you know, if you look at the journey, we moved from after 34 years, we have a national education policy. The last one being 1986, after 34 years, a landmark document that has come into existence is the National Education Policy. I'll very quickly dwell into it. I hope I have enough time because I'm traversing through the education journey what we have. Now, James Joyce, an Irish poet from England, had said that any theory, concept, philosophy, or policy, he compared it to a wick of a lamp. You know, a wick of a lamp, I think we understand better in India because we still have the oil lamps, you know, the wick. So the wick of a lamp, he said, it's like a wick of a lamp. When it smokes, you need to trim the wick. You know, we break the wick, the front portion, and we trim it. But when it smokes heavily, you need to change the wick. This is what he said. And I think NEP 2020, you know, is that change that has been brought into the education system. Again, a landmark, as I said earlier. Now, we need to look at what has happened before this landmark or during the process of this. And I'm going to very briefly dwell on the kind of institutions that we have. You know, look at the state universities that we have. I'm talking about the latest report, 2021, 17th, as of 17th May 2021, we have 437 state universities in the country. And the deemed to be universities are 126 deemed to be by, you know, as on 31st March 2021. And again, as on 31st March 2021, we have 54 central universities. And of course, the private universities are 388, the number going up to almost 1,005. But this is not all. This is not all. Because, you know, as we evolved and innovated, we also innovated 15 professional councils, you know, to dwell on different aspects of accreditation and coordination between the institutions. Over a period of time, the institutions of national importance grew to 135. From 80, somewhere around in 2005, we were about 80 or so. It grew to 135. Now look at the institutions, you know, under the ministries. Ministry of Education, which was until recently was known or identified as MHRD, Ministry of Human Development and Resource. You know, there are about 161 national institutions under HRD, UGC also comes. So UGC has about 1,000 we are talking about already. Now there's 161 institutions, would be 23 IITs, 31 NITs, 20 IIMs. The list can go on. In IITs, as many as 25, 7 ICERs and Indian Institute of Science. Then you have CUs as and SPAs and NITI, all these combined together. Then we have 11 other ministries who also have education as the one of the corollaries there. And you have Ministry of Health as AIIMS, you know, and 22 medical institutions you have which come under Ministry of Health. I'm talking about central government alone, and I'm not dwelling into state governments here. Just to give you an idea as to the varied education system that we have, Ministry of Ayush has 11 institutions. Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers has 7. Ministry of Agriculture has about 7 central agricultural universities. And the NIDs come under Ministry of Commerce and Industry, interestingly. NIFT, of course, the 17 NIFTs that we have, the number has been growing. In Fashion Technology Institutes as Ministry of Textiles. Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports has 3 institutions. Now, this is again very Perambadur, we have an institution there. Ministry of External Affairs, of course, has Nalanda. We are there with them as the only international university. SAU, I'm not counting because that's funded by SAC. But that also comes under MEA. Ministry of Culture, we have a neighboring university that comes under Ministry of Culture. And Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas, there are 2 institutions there, you know, and Ministry of Civil Aviation, we have 1. You know, it's a very interesting, you know, statistical data that I have provided, because look at that, the national institutions under central government alone going up to over 239, of which, as I said, 135 are institutions of national importance. Nalanda happens to be an institution of national importance too. You know, look at the labs, the research labs that we have. I was looking at what do we have where is CSIR labs are concerned. We have 38 of those. And ICAR labs are over 100, 102 perhaps to be exact. These are the data that we have where institutions are concerned. Now, and the varied institutions that we have, which is so difficult for us to run. Because coordinating between institutions is always a challenge. It has grown, as I said, institutions of national importance have grown by 80% from 75, just to give you the data, 75 in 2015 to 135 in 2020. Now, the gross enrollment ratio was, as I said earlier, was 0.1 million in 1950. It went up to 25.9 million by 2012 and 38.5 by 2019 and 2020. You find that 18.9 million are boys, and the girls also rose. It rose up to, girls are 18.9 and boys are 19.6 million. Boys, a remarkable growth. And I think given the kind of institution that we have, so overall, if we look at and we look at the exact number, we have about 1,043 universities in the country and about 42,343 colleges, you know, over 40,000, as our Honorable Prime Minister recently mentioned in Atmanirbhar Bharat speech that he gave. And we have over 11,779 standalone institutions. Now, look at the number of institutions that we have, and also the scheme, the Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan is a corollary to sponsored scheme, which aims at equity, access, and excellence in higher education, where funding is provided by the central government to state governments to assure a quality framework, mandatory quality framework. However, one of the negative here has been that there has been slow progress on this front. The funding that was provided by central government to the state governments to ensure quality framework, utilization is merely 25%. So we need to develop in other core areas as well. Now, government's initiative of grooming 20 universities or institutions as institutions of eminence is laudable, I thought, because you know this is where, because we look at, very often there's a question that we have number of institutions, there's so many are GER, gross enrollment ratios going up, but we don't figure anywhere in 100 top institutions in the world. Now, 100 top institutions in the world, by times they evaluate to be exact 1500 institutions across 93 countries, you know, and India has been figuring there, but in single digit numbers. So we have not been able to, and the reason being that the varied quality assurance has been a problem because of the diversity in the institutions, the mushrooming of institutions, lack of teachers has been a concern. The PhDs who have not been able to find jobs is also a concern, because we find that the quality research is not being done. You know, while UGC is trying to, the accreditation, National Accreditation Center has been trying to evaluate institution, but for various reasons we have not been able to ensure that our PhDs have the quality that is required. So somewhere the fault lines lie with the faculty, with the syllabi, the curricula. These need to be innovated constantly. We need to set benchmarks here, and the faculty development is very important. So the individuals have to also make an effort here. Otherwise, it's very difficult to move forward. Now, the initiative, another important and perhaps a laudable initiative which will stand the test of time is HECI, that is Higher Education Commission of India, which is soon to replace UGC. It promises to fill the present chasms that we have, present gaps. It's a promising institution, I thought, Higher Education Commission of India. But the proof of the pudding, as I generally say, lies in eating. So we don't know. We'll have to see how it shapes up. So education sector requires reforms to change the existing ecosystem to keep pace with the global demands and to provide intellectual capital, not just to our own nation, but beyond. I think the multipolar world, citizens are all global citizens. What has NEP done? You know, NEP is a landmark a policy. Again, how do we, you know, ensure that it becomes, turns into reality, will be tested through the individual institutions, the leadership provided by individual leadership, because we are looking at how this policy is a comprehensive framework from elementary education to higher education to vocational training. The policy aims, you know, most importantly, to transform India's education system per se. School education is again moving from 10 plus 2 structure to 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 model with 5 foundational years here, Anganwadi, preschool, Balvatika, you know, these are very important milestones, because we are also talking about, instead of exams being held every year, school students attend 3 exams in class 2, 5 and 8. You know, this is again a very revolutionary, very innovative way of looking at how NEP was formulated, where performance assessment, review, analysis of knowledge for holistic development was looked into. These exams, NEP also says, need to be conducted twice a year. Where higher education is concerned, this is again very flexible and agile, with exit options, you know, after 1 year with the vocational training with certificate, after 2 years with diploma, after 3 years as professional degree, and 4 years is again a multidisciplinary bachelor's degree, 4 years. So very flexible, very agile system of education with, credit bank that one focuses on. I think that's where it's important that we look at. What I have done in Nalanda is to have a cafeteria model of teaching, and also have extra credit for students to add to their bank of credits. You know, they can opt and they can move with ease from one discipline to another. So breaking the silos is very important. Breaking the silos between humanities and sciences is also, I think, C.P. Snow, in one of his landmark talk that he gave, and this is way back in 1959, you know, in a lecture that he delivered, it was called Two Cultures and the Scientific Revolution, and he said that the intellectual life in the entire Western and European world is split into two cultures, sciences and humanities. And he said, if we want mankind to progress, then we need to bring about synergy between the two. We need to build bridges, and I think that's very important. NEP also focuses on how do we break the silos, multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary. So this policy has been a landmark in many, many ways. I was looking to conclude, I was looking at what our Honorable Prime Minister was saying recently when he spoke about Atmanirbhar Bharat through innovation and entrepreneurship. You know, he spoke about 5 pillars, you know, that would take India forward. And the pillars were that of economy, infrastructure, systems, vibrant demography, and demand. Supply that strengthen demand supply. This is where I thought it's very interesting to look at the demographic aspect that he focused on. And I think only a prime minister of his caliber can envision this kind of innovation. You know, he said that 65% of our youngsters are below the age of 35, as we know. And we have more than 1.4 million schools, and wherein we have 10,500 and more engineering colleges. We have about 40,000 colleges, 42, I gave you the number. Now, India enjoys a demographic dividend like no other country in the world, with so much human resource, because these youngsters would be ruling the world in next 20 years or 30 years. So it's very important that we channelize the youthful energy towards nation building activities, and which would mean that we focus on developing vocational, technical and managerial skills while fostering culture of innovation and entrepreneurship at the school and university level. Moving on to industry, you know, from the university. So innovative ways of leveraging emerging digital technologies. We have seen that in the pandemic time, past 2 years, with the novel corona, all of us have been battling. But it also threw humongous opportunities, and how we've been evolving to various digital platforms to ensure that our students are kept abreast with knowledge. They don't lose a year. You know, I have been ensuring here that we don't lose any time. Students should not lose a year. It's very important that we stick to our academic calendar, and how we do it would depend on our own innovative thinking, how we bring to the table new ways of involving digital platforms, and maybe difficult, but not impossible. So huge opportunity that EdTech startups, need to be built, because this will, what would happen is AI technologies need to be leveraged. And for that, we need to have a new curricula where we find that technology is merged with knowledge, because without that, we cannot. So fostering startups, vocational training in the emerging new areas, given the challenges, we look at the huge fires in Greece and California, even US. You know, we are battling with climate change that cannot be contained. The only thing we can do is we have enough research to see how do we protect the future generations from any kind of malnutrition or health hazards, the pollution, clean energy. You know, how do we provide? So we need to find new solutions to emerging global problems that we need to face. So education has constantly been innovating in India. Now we are working on smart villages, smart cities. This would involve that youngsters work towards evolving new ways of moving forward. You know, we also find that past decade, the world has shown us that in scientific, engineering, and technological capabilities, India has emerged on top because the human capital provided by India. So our knowledge system has been so sound, our discipline of learning has been so sound that the software companies have been hiring engineers from India, any number. The reason being that our disciplines have been very tight, and where students move from here abroad and fetch for themselves. You look at the top companies are headed by Indians. This comes from our own discipline, our own knowledge, ethos and tradition, and our education system. So we have been doing very well, I should say, but there's always scope for improvement. And I think it's important that we look at ourselves as to how do we further innovate? How do we enhance the research metrics? Do we have moonshot research? Do we fund? Like in the US, you had cancer funding. It funded heavily into cancer research, which is called moonshot research. So do we fund? So our funding for research needs to go up. You know, this is very important. Strategic planning and management of education is important. The education leaders need to innovate, constantly innovate, and ensure that the faculty and the students, the curricula is kept abreast with the changing times. We cannot be teaching what we have been teaching all these years, because we need to take another look at our curricula. We need to constantly keep working on. So this is very important. You know, academic leadership with integrity is very, very important. A futuristic way of looking at education. For me, future is now. You know, I generally say that. Future is now. I'm not waiting for another 10 years to bring about a change. I have to do it right now. So for me, future is now. On that note, I say thank you to all of you and to Disha Bharat for giving me the opportunity. I hope I have looked at the trajectory of education from different perspectives and brought to the fore how we have evolved and innovated. And I think we are doing very well. We need to get better. Thank you. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, Professor Singh. That was a very interesting talk that straddled millennia over a period of time, and also compressed the last 75 years or so into a very enriching and insightful conversation. Yes, there were lots of statistics about how many universities we had in 1947, how many we have now, but more importantly, you spoke about how the Indian education system has evolved, especially after independence, in terms of, you know, for the first 40 odd years, adapting to the context, to the needs of the country at that time. And you then took a deep dive into NEP 2020 as an instrument of change, mass transformation that is going to prepare the nation for the future. And as you just concluded, the future starts now and the future starts with us. So it's about personal responsibility. It is about ensuring that the entire ecosystem works together. And, you know, Disha Bharat works closely with faculty, institutions and students. So we have a ringside view of some of the changes that are going on, also some of the challenges that we as an ecosystem are facing. And with your permission, ma'am, I'd like to sort of now ask some of the questions that some participants have sort of thrown at us. Let me begin with this. You spoke briefly about India's ranking globally in terms of research and as universities and overall. So as of now, we see only a couple of our institutions counted amongst the top 200 globally. We would all like to see many more of our HEIs featured, not just in the top 200, but eventually in the top 100 and top 10 as well. According to you, what are the top three actions that we as a nation can take starting now to accelerate our progress on this path?
Well, that's a very good question. So let me begin by saying that what ails us? Why is it that we don't figure there? And I don't think India is doing too badly, given that our responsibility is a social responsibility where education is concerned. You know, we give any number of fellowships and scholarships to our students from underprivileged section, and we are trying to move them up the ladder, you know. So this social responsibility that education has to a large extent, to my mind, is one of the best thing that has that India has been doing. And this somewhere does not place us in the bracket of ranking. That's one. Point number two is to rank in the top institutions, you need to have international students. You know, some of the criteria there, India will not figure because we do not have international students. We have not promoted our institutions as international institutions. It's ICCR that gives fellowship to a number of students and they come. But if you look at the number has been growing, but it's not the same. So naturally, and where research is concerned, again, the we are a teaching institutions mostly. You know, it's knowledge dissemination and not knowledge creation. So the kind of research, one of the evaluating criteria is what is the research fund that the university has attracted? You know, we don't have that kind of. So naturally, science and technology institutions do attract that. So these are some of the things where which we need to bear in mind and not find fault with our education system for not being there in the top 100. We're going to be there shortly, but we need to be patient. We need to work towards all these parameters. We need to understand what are the parameters to figure there. So if we work on our research, you know, let there be more funding for research. You know, that's very important. Let our faculty be more research oriented. You know, that is very important. We need to attract international students, then our curricula need to be reworked upon. NEP does promise all that. So I'm not disappointed. I've always maintained that we should work towards it, not be disappointed, and keep going. And I think we will be there.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you. I know it is past seven, but with your permission, ma'am, since there are so many questions, I'll try to sort of consolidate them and ask a couple more.
Yeah.
You know, in some sense, this is a follow-on. Critical thinking and analytical skills are the cornerstones of all research. And however, sometimes our academic leadership and faculty and therefore students find themselves at crossroads. The focus is on marks, then do you sort of focus on ensuring that they know the answers, the right answers and so on, or do they sort of critically think and ask questions and so on. So what would be your advice to leaders of institutions and faculty to help inculcate these capabilities in students?
You know, my advice to my faculty and their curricular preparation is concerned, it's very important that we understand knowledge. That's why I started with Darshan and Gyan, the difference between, because Darshan is developing that those capabilities that translate into Gyan. So critical thinking is one of the most, this is Atman and Vidhi, that means the self-realization comes with critical thinking. Critical thinking has been intrinsic to Indian ethos. The colonial rule, which has somewhere robbed us of our self-esteem in many, many ways, that we have forgotten to think, to reflect, to be original. And I think in institutions, it's important that we teach and imbibe those qualities. I have started a course here in critical thinking, and I found a huge resistance from some faculty.
How attractive was the course to students?
New perspectives. Important to have this kind of a, you know, so I think every institution should look at new courses, have credits for critical thinking. That's very important.
And that is probably also something that, you know, the academic bank for credit will sort of help, as you said, break the silos between art, science, commerce, all of that stuff. So that's again something that probably will be useful there. And a question specific to sort of, you know, in the sense, please share with us your views on what more needs to be done to research Bharat's ancient bodies of knowledge and contextualize them to today's world so that there is more spontaneous interest in youth. And this probably has a link to Nalanda and, you know, the...
Yes, of course, it has a very deep connection with Nalanda. But I think we have to pool our knowledge. Pooling of Indian knowledge has not been done. We need to look at our own Gyan Parampara, right? Because for us, knowledge was part of our spiritual journey. It was not a materialistic journey to begin with. While it gave us, you know, we need to, the resource pool of knowledge from the ancient world needs to be collated. I think that's the first step, I would say. Institutions should learn to do that and pick aspects of it and teach. We are starting a course on Hindu studies, masters, where I'm collating and pooling the knowledge tradition from different texts, from Vedas, Upanishads, the Vedantic tradition, the Itihas. Itihas is Ramayana and Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita. You need to do that. How many takers would there be? Maybe we start with a small number, but there will be. It's a promising thing. So I think it's important, pooling of our own knowledge resources. We've been too colonial in our mindset. So I think we need to move towards Indian aesthetics, look at our own shastras. You know, in Indian knowledge tradition, shastra and shastra, defense studies was also part of it. We no longer have that. So somewhere I think it's important to bring maritime security that Honorable Prime Minister was talking about. New courses and link it with the earlier traditions and see how we move forward. I think that would be my advice.
Thank you. That's very fascinating as well, because, you know, in some sense, it's a cycle. Yeah. We've sort of, a lot of things that Western researchers seem to be uncovering is found in our ancient texts. And then suddenly we are like, oh, okay, we already knew this. But, and the whole context of, you know, the world itself is changing today. The physical, the metaphysical, and even in the West, as a coach, people talk about leadership and so on. People are looking inwards. They are sort of talking about how do you look inwards and seek. So we've always been a nation of seekers. We've sought knowledge at the highest level, not just material. One other question that, with your permission, what can we do to ensure that parental paradigms shift suitably? That's an interesting question. We talk about policy, NEP 2020, enablers and all of that. But if parents continue to want their kids to be doctors or engineers or what have you, then what?
Yeah, I think that's a big challenge. The mindset needs to be changed. But then when we look at young parents, I'm really very amazed and happy to see the trends changing in the young parents, 30, 35 year old, having one child or maximum two or not more than one. But also they pick and choose education very well. The only cause for concern is in today's time, the parents are scared of children, not the other way around, on a lighter note, which somewhere we are not able to, you know, that has a negative facet, which means that we are not able to guide our children very well. In India, we still do it. We guide them. You know, we ensure that they study and there's unbroken way up in education. In US and other countries, students take a break of 2 or 3 years and then they find it difficult to launch themselves. So it has its pluses and minuses. And I don't want to blame the youngsters because youngsters are far smarter than my generation, I thought, of people. So I think we should leave parents alone. Let them figure out how they would want to bring up their children. The only thing that I would insist is don't lose the sense of values that we have. Because ethics and values are the most important, because character building begins from home, begins with parents, and then it happens in institutions. So that's where I think we need to be very, very cautious. Cautious optimism, I would say. I would use these two words.
Yes, indeed. Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Singh. One last question, if I may. You know, the NEP 2020 is being seen as a ray of hope for educational reforms in India that are, you know, relevant to not just the current, but for the future of India and the way the world is evolving. But given the experience of Disha Bharat, we find that very often school levels or even at college level, teachers are not completely aware of what the NEP 2020 sort of will mean for them and what it is that they need to do to adapt and what it is that they need to prepare. So any sort of parting thoughts on that? What institutions need to focus on?
My advice would be that heads of the institutions, faculty, everyone must read NEP closely. It's a document worth reading because then you can jot down what can be done in a short duration within 5 years, what can be done in a longer space of time. One can actually set timelines and do it. So reading it is very, because the schools, school education has been drafted so well. It's a seamless synergy that happens. The higher education too, barring I would say that single discipline institutions, I think for a holistic education, multidisciplinary education, it's one document that's extremely revolutionary in many, many ways. And if we are true to the word, I think we will be able to, and I'm reminded of what Emily Dickinson said, and maybe I will quote her here, because she said, we never know how high we rise till we are called to rise. And then if we are true to the plan, our stature touches the skies. And I think NEP, if we are true to the plan, then yes, our stature will touch skies. I'm talking about the Indian stature, of course.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Professor Singh. for a truly fascinating conversation. Thank you so much, everybody. Over to you, Rekha ji, for your... Okay.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. Decolonize the important, you've given a great message to decolonize our mindset, and we need to look into our own Gyan Parampara. That was a great message from you. And of course, you've ended the entire speech with a great positive and very optimistic approach and the way forward for the Indian education. Thank you so much, ma'am. It's a deep gratitude, sense of gratitude. We thank you for this program.
My pleasure.
Namaste, ma'am. Namaste. Namaste. Okay, namaste.